So last time I started the discussion on switching trajectory. Right now you know what they are. It shows you the behavior, dynamic behavior of the waveforms, right? Voltage and current of the switch when they are going through the switching transition, right? And the way we do that is by plotting voltage across the switch as well as current through the switch by using what we call IV plot, right? So the y-axis is current, the x-axis is V, and based on the switching transition, shape of the behavior during switching transition, you can then draw the switching trajectory, okay? And switching trajectory, as I mentioned last time, the disadvantage is that, it does not involve the time or the duration of the switching transition, so that information gets lost in the switching trajectory, but you still get the idea of how voltage and current travels, right, as they are going through the switching transition. And that is important when we talk about the next topic, which is SOA. But for now, that's basically what switching trajectory is, you know, starting from the ideal case, right? And then linear commutation, and I ask you to do this yourselves. And this last one is the rectangular commutation, rectangular switching. And that's the reason why we call this rectangular, because the switching trajectory shapes like a triangle, like a rectangular, right? Just like that, right there. And so because the switching trajectory does not show the duration of the time, see like this one right there, we can see clearly if you do it in the time domain, right? This one is time domain. You can see that the switching transition takes that long, right? For turning on and takes that long for turning off, right? And those are the times that are not being represented here or shown here on the switching trajectories. And because of that, we will not be able to compute power loss, switching loss in this case, from switching trajectory. So don't try to find or calculate switching loss from any one of these trajectories, right? You will not be able to. Why? Well, because switching loss, you need the time, right? Remember that power is equal to energy over time. So you need to find the time here, right, in order to be able to get the loss, right, switching loss. So again, for switching loss calculation, switching trajectory will not be able to provide that. In order to calculate switching loss, you have to go back to the time domain waveforms, right, of the voltage and current of the switch right there. So if I redraw this on the next page, right, and I assign some numbers, right, so that's the same switching transition as you can see, right? So we have the voltage right here, the current right here. You can see that this will give you the rectangular switching trajectory. But if you want to calculate switching loss, you need to multiply voltage and current with respect to time, right? Well, let me turn on the table, my tablet here. Come on. Oh, I forgot to connect this. Right, so while I'm doing this, so in order for us to be able to calculate power loss, you need to apply the average power equation from E410 or from 212 as well. That average power, in this case, average switching loss, right, should be equal to the average of instantaneous power during switching transition. Right. So here you should have average power of the switching, so switching loss should be equal to 1 over T, right? Integral from 0 to T of P of T, dt, right? So this is strictly calculated during switching transition. So that's going to be equal to 1 over T, right? 0 to T, V of T, I of T, product of voltage and current. All right. So that's what the red waveform is. That's P of T. Right. For the first one, the first triangle, that's what is that on? Right. So that's P on. And then the second triangle, that's P of T off. Right there. Okay. But those are instantaneous power, right? If you want to get average power, then you have to divide it by the period, right? So this equation, as you already learned right here, that's none other than the area of the area under the curve, right? The area under P of T. So in our example here, if you start multiplying voltage and current, you'll get a triangle. And so therefore, the average would be the area under the curve, under the red, divided by the period. So let's see if you agree with me first. How do I get this triangle? Well, again, the transition starts from here, right? And you can see that as current is increasing, right? Voltage across the switch is staying constant, right? So then, therefore, if you multiply current and voltage, instantaneous power is going to be linearly increasing, right? Because the other parameter is constant here. So the slope right there times a constant would give you a constant slope, right? And the way, to me, the easiest way to draw this is by finding the point where the two maximum points are intersecting each other, right? So here is the maximum point of the current during the transition. And here is also the, at the same time, simultaneously is the maximum point of the voltage, right? So this point, this voltage times this current should give you the peak value of P of T, P max, right, of T. You agree with that? Because that's the worst case point for the power. When the voltage is reaching its peak value, as well as the current is reaching its peak value. So if you multiply the two at the same exact time, that should give you the peak of instantaneous power. And that would give you the triangle, right? So you just need to have two points, you know, this point and the beginning point, and that would be the end of the transition anyways, right there, right? That's the end of the transition. So then you can draw the P of T waveforms. Is that good? So do you agree with me that the shape of P of T should be a triangle there, right? All right, if you agree.
Can you repeat which points we need?
Which point, I'm sorry?
Can you repeat which points we need?
You need just the peak and the lowest, I should say, right? The lowest happens when one of them is zero. That happens to be at the beginning of the transition right here. That's when current is equal to zero and voltage is max, right? Right there, that point. So if you multiply these two, you get zero watts, right? And then the other point is where the two are max. So for this transition, max of the current is right there. And max of the voltage is still right here, right? So they both occur at the same time, right here, at this time right here, which happens to be the end of the switching transition. So therefore this should give you the peak of the instantaneous power. So now you got another point, right? Worst case point right there. So now that you have the two points, you can connect the two and you can see you have a triangle right there. And after that, you can see that after this point right there, current is zero, voltage is, sorry, voltage is zero, current is max. So if you multiply the two, you get zero all the way, right? And this is also the point where this transition ends, right there.
Does that answer?
Okay. Okay. Any other questions, or am I confusing you? All right. If there's no questions, then you can see if you agree with me that instantaneous power on the turning on is a triangle shape, right? And so therefore, in order to find the average power from instantaneous power, what do? You find the area of this triangle and then divide it by the period, right? That should give you the average power loss. of that triangle. Right, and I can do the same thing with turning off right here. And since they're since they both are the same transition shape, right? You can see both gives you rectangular switching trajectory, and then you're going to end up with another triangle for turning off, right? If you follow the same thing, right? That's the worst case because you have peaks for both voltage and current. So this is I peak and this is a voltage peak. So you get the peak of the power right there. And then the transition ends when current goes to zero right there, right? And you get V peak times 0 amps. That's the end of the transition. So now you get a triangle shape as well, okay? And so how do you find average power loss here? Same thing, you find the area of this triangle divided by the period, right? Following this equation right there, right? Find the area and then divide it by the period right there. Any question on this? Area under P of T. Right. Now keep in mind that for this example, P of T is easy to find. Sorry, area of P of T. The area of P of T is easy to find because it's just a triangle. Right? Many cases, it's not as easy. So you have to carry out the integration instead of, you know, finding an area of a certain shape. Right? So for this example, it's quite straightforward because again, the shape of P of T happens to be a triangular waveform. Any question on this? All right, so once you recognize the P of T, the shape of P of T, now you can do the calculation of switching loss, right? So there is a typo here, so please fix it in your book. This would be area of triangle 2. Sorry about that. And this also area of triangle 2. So now you know that switching loss will consist of two transition, right? Pre-turn on and pre-turn off. P turn on is area of triangle 1 divided by the period, as I said earlier, plus P turn off, the turn off loss, switching loss is coming from the second triangle divided by the period, the same period. Okay? And dividing by period is the same as multiplying it with switching frequency, right? It's the inverse of switching frequency. So if you know what the switching frequency is and you know all of this timing, you should be able to find the switching loss. So in our example, I've assigned numbers. So you can see that voltage peak right there is 10 volts. Current peak is 15 amps. So I know that, well, let me erase this because it gets so crowded here. So you can see that the height of this triangle is 10 times 15, right? So the height, this height right there should be 15 times 10, right? So that's coming from these two points right there. So 15 times 10 gives you 150 watts, right? And the base that's given as 0.1 microseconds. So that's how long the switching on, the turning on transition is taking place. So 0.1 micro. So now by knowing the height and the base, you should be able to find the area of the triangle. Same thing here on the turning off. You can see that the peak is the same, 150 watts, and the base is now 0.2 micro. So gotta watch out for that because that's different from the first one. So now you have a different area for turning off. So that's what I should have here. Let's see if that's correct. Area of triangle is the height times the base divided by 2, right there. So that's correct, right? 150 times the base, 0.1 divided by 2, plus for the turning off, 150 watts times 0.2 microseconds, the base divided by 2. And then you multiply by the switching frequency. Do I have the switching frequency information here? Oh no. Oh, right here. Switching frequency is 100 kilohertz, right? So that's why I multiply that by 100 kilohertz. And that gives you the switching loss right there. Any questions here? So again, the idea here is to show you an example of how you would calculate switching loss from a time domain voltage and current waveforms. Okay, you do that during switching transition. You do a V times I, and then find the integral of that. If the shape happens to be an easy shape to find the area, then use and then just calculate the area under the curve. If not, then you just have to multiply the two and then carry out the integral, right? And then divide it by period. Any questions? So I'm expecting you to know how to calculate this, okay? You'll see in the end of chapter problems, which as you know, those are past midterm problems that in some of the problems in the midterm I gave this type of problems where you need to calculate switching loss, okay? Okay, this picture right here shows a real world example of a buck converter. Someday I would need to do this myself because I just copy from some other article. I don't remember which article here, but it shows the switching trajectory right there on the right hand side. And then let me make it smaller. And then the switching waveforms, right? So on the left side, you see switching waveforms, this and this one, the top and the bottom one on the left, and the right-hand side right there, that's the corresponding switching trajectory. So you can see from the top left, this is gotta be turning off, right? Because that's IDS and that's VDS. So that's current through the switch, voltage across the switch. You can see current drops while voltage goes up. So that's a turning off transition. So if you do the switching trajectory, then you get very close to rectangular trajectory, like the example that I had earlier, right? That's turning off. Turning on is this one right here, that's turning on. How do I know? Well, because ID goes from zero to some value, that's turning on. And then VDS, voltage across the MOSFET, drops from some value to zero, right? And although it's very hard to see the overlapping, but if you zoom in, there's gotta be some overlaps there. And that would give you the switching trajectory right here, right? Now, let me ask you this, by looking at the switching trajectory, right? I know earlier I said that you cannot calculate switching loss in watts from switching trajectory, but you get an idea of how bad the switching loss is, right? By looking at switching trajectory, that's what I mentioned last time. So from this example, can you tell me which one's gonna give you the worst switching loss? Is it turning on or turning off?
The top one.
Yes.
Turning off, yeah.
Exactly, right? So although you cannot get the numerical value of the switching loss, but you get an idea of, you know, how bad is the loss you get from each of the transition, right? Which one is worse or which one is better? So you can tell from here that turning off covers more area than turning on, right? So this indicates that the switching loss from turning off is going to give you more watts than the turning on of the switch, right? And that's typically the case with a switch, right? A switch typically taking a longer time to turn off than to turn on, okay? So this is very typical. Any questions? Now, can you do this in the lab? Absolutely, you know, if you have the physical lab, I would ask you to, like last year, for example, students actually did this where they do a trajectory, right? You can actually do this trajectory with oscilloscope, right? We don't call it trajectory. Usually we call it XY plot, right? You're familiar with XY plot, right? In oscilloscope. And that's what you do in order to get switching trajectory. You change the mode of the oscilloscope to XY plot, where, you know, X is the voltage and the Y axis, you change it to current, right? Any question on that? Right, okay, so keep in mind that you could do this in the lab, right? All right, sorry, the only trick that you need to realize though is that oscilloscope, standard conventional oscilloscope does not measure current, right? It measures voltage. And so you're gonna have to find a way to convert, you know, current through the switch to voltage, right? Different methods. You learned it from last quarter, right? Different ways to change current to voltage, right? So keep that in mind. Okay. Any questions about switching trajectory? Okay, if not, why is switching trajectory important for us to learn? Because this is where we can, this is a tool, right? Switching trajectory is a tool for us to be able to understand or determine whether or not a switch that you're operating will be good enough for the converter that you are designing, right? By using switching trajectory with respect to what's called SOA. Right? So SOA stands for safe operating area. So every MOSFET or switch that you use for power converters will have an SOA curve in the data sheet, right? Before I go there, typically manufacturers will provide two types of data with respect to the transition state. That's our focus now, right? Transition state, switching state. Right? First is the time behavior of the device, provides estimates of how long the device will remain in commutations, you know, rise time and fall times. Usually it has a table that shows this, internal time delay and recovery time. Again, usually these are all provided, you know, as numbers in the table. But the second data that you can get from a manufacturer's data sheet, which relates to switching trajectory, is called safe operating area, right? I'll show you an example right here. So I chose this MOSFET from Vishay, right? IRF 510. So you can see that this is the data sheet of that MOSFET. Right. You can see the rise time right there, fall time, right? Rise time, fall time, turn off delay, and so on and so forth. Those are the first type of data you get. In addition to that, right, you also get this data that is related to switching trajectory. Again, it's called SOA. Here. See that? SOA, safe operating area, right? This is where you get the current on the y-axis and voltage on the x-axis, right? So what you're learning in chapter one, is it chapter one still? It is still chapter one, is a very practical, you know, tool that we use, right? When we go deeper into operating, you know, the switch, right? So as you can see, this is provided. So now the next thing is, after this chapter, now you know how to make use of this data, right? Before, you probably seen it before, and then you're probably just gonna skip it, right? Because you don't know how to use this curve. Now you do, after we're done with chapter one, after we're done with the class today, okay? So how do we make use of this information, right? That's the objective of this section, right? Discussing the safe operating area, right? So let's start there. What is SOA? SOA is a region of the VI plane or switching trajectory that the actual switching trajectory of the switch when you operate it must fall inside, right? So SOA defines limits of maximum limits of how you can operate the switch within the converter that you are designing. Right, so the actual switching trajectory, the one that you learned the previous section, right? I force you to go through this. You know, I explained some examples, and then I force you to do an example or two for switching trajectory previously, right? And those switching trajectories, once you draw those, the switching trajectory must fall inside SOA, right? So SOA that you get from the data sheet defines the limits, maximum limits. Right here, and right here as an example. Okay, and then when you draw the switching trajectory of the switch that is being used in the converter, that switching trajectory must fall inside. If it goes outside, then the switch could either be a damage or the circuit's not going to be operating properly. Okay, so let's talk more about this. But before that, any question about what SOA is? So again, SOA basically defines maximum limits for a particular switch to operate. And we'll talk more about the limits.
I have a quick question.
Yeah, go ahead.
So I know the safe operating area comes from the manufacturing data sheet, but is there like rules of thumb on like how close we can get, or is it assumed like, oh, as long as it falls within as long as the switching trajectory falls within safe operating area, we're good? Because what I'm trying to get at is like, oh, if there's like, you know, some spikes in voltage or current, it might for a moment be outside, but is there some sort of tolerance or thing we should account for?
Yeah, so if you hold on for that question, I think that's part of the explanation that I'll do today, right?
Okay.
So let's go through that those limits first, and you still have the same question, then let me know, okay? The short answer to your question is depending on the limits. Right? There's some limits that are absolute, but it's actually one that is absolute, and the other one is a function of time, function of duration of the transient. Okay, that's the short answer to your question. But let's go through the details and see if you still have the same question after we go through the different limits. Is that okay, Russell? Was it Russell?
Yeah. Thank you. Okay. That's fine, yeah, thanks.
All right. Okay, so what constitute SOA boundaries? Right. Different devices have different SOA parameters, right? We have power limit, current limit, voltage limit, second breakdown, saturation boundary. So, you know, variations and many variations of different limits. But in general, it has at least three, right? The one that I'm showing here, right? Let's take a look at those three first. Look at this one right here, right? What do you think this limit constitutes right there, that horizontal line right there, the flat line?
Current limit?
Current limit, exactly. That's the current limit of the device, okay? How about this one right here, the vertical line right there?
Voltage.
Voltage. What about this one right here that has a slope? What do you think that is?
Power.
Power, yes. Voltage times current will give you this, right? Ideally, you want to have a square shape, but that usually is not the case, right? Has to do with thermal limitation of the junction in the MOSFET as well as in IGBTs, right? So that's why it's not, you cannot just do voltage times current, right? So it's gonna be a different limit for power. So power is also equivalent to thermal limit, right? So you have a current limit, at least every device should have current limit. Every device should have voltage limit, and every device should have thermal limit, okay? So those are the three main ones. Beyond these three, it would depend on the type of the switch, okay? We'll go over several examples. For power MOSFET, the main ones are those three, same one, but it's actually another one I'll show you later. But the basic one that you need to really pay attention to are the three limits: current, thermal, and voltage, right? Next. Transistor. So go ahead and compare the SOA of MOSFET versus transistor. Now that's a MOSFET, and here's the transistor. If you get to choose between the two, which one would you rather use? If you have the choices of using either MOSFET or a transistor, which one? Which one would you rather choose based on the SOA?
MOSFET,
right? Why? Why do you answer that?
You got straight lines for like 1 and 3 on the last figure are like straight solid lines. They're better.
Okay.
Less power loss.
Okay, very good.
Less that could go wrong.
Exactly. So if you use MOSFET, you have less to worry about, right? There's actually four limits, but the number four is actually a self-protecting. I'll show you later. But just the basic one, you can see that it has three limits that you have to worry about. Whereas transistor, when you use transistor, you have to worry about how many? Six limits, right? If I were you, I would definitely choose a MOSFET because I have less to worry about, right? Remember, SOA defines limits. So the less limits that is restricting the use of the switch, the better, right? The more limits, the more headaches, basically, right? So that's another reason why power BJTs have become less and less popular for power electronics. Because then, if you are using power BJTs, then you have to really be careful on how you operate that BJTs, you know, making sure that it does not go above this SOA. All right. Whereas MOSFET, you just need to worry about mainly three limits. Make sense? Of course, there are other reasons of why power BJTs are less popular nowadays. Switching speed, right? Power handling capability is also very low, right? So that's why it's becoming less and less popular. Let's talk about the different boundaries here for BJTs, for power transistors. Number one is saturation boundary. Right. Number two is peak current, right? That's the same as the MOSFET right there, the flat line. And number five must be the voltage, right? And then three and four, right? Three is peak power, four is second breakdown. Right? This is unique to a transistor. Right? That's not, MOSFETs and IGBT don't have this limit, but in BJTs, you do have this second breakdown limit. Again, I'm not an expert on this, but I have included what second breakdown means. I'll let you read through this. But what I just want to show you is that when you use BJTs, you have to be careful on this number four, right? This additional limit called second breakdown, right? And then number five is voltage breakdown, as I said earlier. And then number six is cutoff limit. So you have saturation limit number six, cutoff limit number, saturation limit number one, cutoff limit number six, voltage number five, current number two, thermal or power number three, and second breakdown, which is unique to power BJTs on number four. Okay, so that's power BJTs. IGBTs. All right. I copy-pasted this from, looks like from this reference, so that's from a data sheet of an IGBT. SOA of an IGBT, you can see there's four limits, number one, number two, number three, and number four, right? Similar to a MOSFET, right? What are these limits? Well, this limit is the same as MOSFET, that's current limit, right? And there is a voltage limit for IGBTs, and that's current limit for IGBTs. And this is what we call the self-protecting limit. So I don't think you need to worry about, because this is following physics, right? Basically a resistance forward resistance of the IGBTs. So when IGBT is conducting current, it will have resistance, right? Of this inherent resistance of this IGBT. And that resistance follows Ohm's law. So you would never be able to violate this limit because it follows, you know, physics, right? V over I, right? So when you apply voltage and then current that you can push toward this IGBT would be depending on this limit. Right. Again, that's something that you cannot violate. Right. So that's even though the limit is here, but you would never be able to violate this. Right. Okay. And the one that has the slope right here, that's the same as before. That's thermal or power limit. Notice that we have different lines. Okay. Different lines, what does that mean? Well, different lines means that it would be a function of the duration of the current. The longer the current that you apply to this IGBT, the lower the limit. You can see that the one for DC means continuous current, flat current. You can see that IGBT can handle lower power limit. See that lower power limit if the current is continuous or DC in this case. So it's being measured based on pulse current, something like this. So if the pulse current stays on the whole time, that's DC. This is the zero. And here's the zero as well, right? Then if it's DC, then that corresponds to a larger power dissipation. That's why the limit for the power is less. And as the duration of the current gets smaller, right, from DC to 1 millisecond, to 100 microsecond, to 10 microsecond, that corresponds to this pulse right here, right? So from DC to, imagine now it's 1 milli, and then you decrease down to 100 micro and so on and so forth, the limit goes up. See that? So this relates to Russell's, your question relates to this. And so it depends on the duration of the current, right? If the duration is very short, then definitely can handle more power. Okay. Any question on this? Notice that current, in this case, doesn't really show, but current actually also is a function of duration, but voltage though. Voltage is an absolute limit, and I'm just gonna go over the MOSFET to clarify this. Not this one, but the next one, I believe. Yeah, let's go ahead to show you this next one right there. All right, so this is a more realistic SOA that you typically get from a MOSFET as well as IGBTs. Notice that I've talked about power limits. See that? That is as a function of the duration of the current, right? From DC, and then the shorter the pulse, the more power limit it can allow. See that? You see that? That we have multiple limits, right? Depending on, again, duration of the pulse of the current. Take a look at the current limit as well, the flat lines. You see that the flat lines is also, there are also multiple flat lines. Again, those are corresponding to the different duration of the current. So if you wanna see the limit, if let's say you are using this switch, this MOSFET for DC current, then the limits that you'll be using is, let me use the red, you're gonna be using, if it's DC, you're gonna be using this SOA for DC, okay? So this IDC right there, for the current limit, that's the power DC, and that's the voltage for DC current. What if you have a switching frequency, right? PWM, well, if the PWM gives you let's say 100 microseconds pulse current, then the SOA for that will change, right, to, I'm gonna use a different color, will change to, let's say green. Change to this. So I'm gonna try to follow this curve right there. And then right there, right there, and right there. Okay, so now you have different SOA limits for 100 microseconds as indicated by this number label right there. So that's the RDS on, you cannot violate that. And there's the current limit for 100 microseconds. That's the power limit for 100 microseconds, and that's the voltage limit for 100 microseconds. Any question on those two examples for DC and for 100 microseconds? Identifying or determining which SOA limits you need to follow given different, you know, pulse current duration. Okay, if there's no question, then what is common in both examples? What limit is common to both examples?
Current, voltage, and power.
Only voltage, because power, they're different, right? You can see power for 10 micro is right here. and for DC is right there. So different, right? So only voltage. So you can see that one limit that does not change with the duration of the current is voltage, right? That makes sense because, you know, voltage an absolute limit, right? If MOSFET is rated at 100 volts, then that 100 volt is not gonna be a function of temperature or a function of duration of the current at all. That's an absolute, limit, right? It has to do with, you know, the clearance, right? The distance between the channels or things like that, right? Something that I'm not an expert of, but, you know, keep in mind that, you know, voltage is something that that should not be affected by how much current you push through this MOSFET, right? So that's why every chip, for example, has voltage rating, and you are not allowed to go above that voltage rating, right? Whereas current, it really depends on how much current you are pushing through this device or this chip, right? So that's why voltage is an absolute rating for a switching device. Okay, so that's very important to understand. So anytime you are using a switch, it doesn't matter if it's a MOSFET or IGBTs, the one limit that you have to be very careful of is, extra careful of, is voltage. And that voltage, again, it doesn't matter how much duration of the current is, will be the same, regardless of the amount of current you push through this device. It's an absolute limit. Any questions? So that will be the same for IGBT as well, as you can see from the previous example. Oh, sorry, not that one. Right there, see, there's only one. The only thing that this doesn't show is the current. The current should also be a function of duration there. All right. Any questions on this? So I have more explanation on each of the limits. Right, that's the voltage right there, breakdown limit. That's the breakdown voltage of the device right there. That's why it's absolute. Permanent damage may occur if this voltage limit exceeded for even very short durations of time. So be careful. Any question on the SOA? So now you know how to make use of or utilize this this SOA from manufacturers, okay? You look at the switching trajectory of the device that you are using in the circuit, in the converter. If let's say that this switching trajectory follows, for example, this path, then if it's 1 millisecond pulse current, then, you know, that's safe, right? Because that's within the SOA. But if let's say that if you are, again, using 1 millisecond pulse current, and the switching trajectory now changes to, let's say, you know, this much, then you need to worry about that, because it violates the power limit of the device. Okay, and that means what? If it goes over the power limit, it means the device is going to be heating up, right? And the device might be able to handle it, but you know what happens when you overheat a device, right? It will shorten the lifetime of that device, right? So now that device will not last for a long time if you keep exceeding the thermal limit, right? If the switching trajectory goes like this, it doesn't matter what current you're pushing through that MOSFET, you need to change the MOSFET. You need to change the switch if it goes above the voltage limit. That means, you know, this is not a good MOSFET for you to use, right? You need to find a different MOSFET where the SOA voltage limit, you know, is not exceeded by the trajectory. Does that make sense to you, what we've talked about so far? Yes?
Yeah.
Okay, good. I just want to make sure that, you know, we're still following the discussion here. All right, so let's move on to the next topic then. Share this screen again. All right, the next one is now that we know, now that we understand switching trajectory, how can we, how we can use switching trajectory with respect to information that manufacturer is providing us. The next thing would be still on the switching loss, right? Now that we understand how to analyze, how to calculate switching loss, then the next thing would be, okay, so now that we know more about switching loss, the next step would be, is there any way we can minimize switching losses, right? Because that would be good to know. If the switching loss that you calculated turns out to be quite significant, then the next logical step is to reduce that switching loss, right? To improve efficiency of the converter. So what are the different ways of minimizing switching losses? Right, there are three different ways. We're going to talk about the last two right here, snubber circuits and soft switching. The first one, again, this is not a device physics class, so I'm not gonna go over these in details. I can give you examples. So the first way to, first method to minimize switching losses is to improve the device technology. You go into the device level, device physics level of the switch and change things around, redesign, right? So on and so forth. So you can have improved performance of the device, right? Again, that's not my interest, right? But that's a way. That's a way to minimize switching losses. Another way that we're going to discuss in this class is adding snubber circuits. It's very common to use snubber circuits to minimize switching losses. Another method that I like the most, this is the way of the future, in my opinion, is implementing soft switching. I think this is a technique that is being used more and more these days, is soft switching, as opposed to PWM. Right? So in E410, you learn about PWM. In E411, you learn about soft switching, a different switching technique. Right? Awesome stuff. Trust me, it's awesome. Still amaze me to this, you know, to this day. You know, this simple method of achieving very low switching losses. You'll find out that the method that we use is not really a fancy circuit that we add. You know, it's very simple circuit, a circuit that you learn in 212. We implement it here to give us soft switching. All right, so that's not the next chapter, but I think the chapter after, I believe. Okay, so yeah, we're going to cover the last two, snubber circuits and soft switching. For the first method, improving device characteristic, I can give you some examples. I'm more of the user of these devices. So I follow, of course, I'm still following new technologies in devices. I don't really care about how they make it, but I care about how to use it. So this is an example of, you know, new technologies and IGBTs. You know, I learned it from articles that I oftentimes receive through email. I'm still following those. And this is one example where they improve IGBT's turnoff characteristics. Like one of the drawbacks of IGBTs is that it is slow compared to MOSFETs. Slow because of the tail current that it has is long. See, that's conventional IGBTs, it has long tail current. When it turns off, it's really dragging, you know, the current before it goes to zero. So they found a way to internally, you know, change the structure of the IGBT to make it faster. See that tail current? Now it's faster. Why is that important to achieve? Well, if you could make that tail current shorter, then of course the amount of overlapping, see the overlapping here? Before and after, look at after, is smaller, right? So the smaller, the shorter time voltage and current overlap during switching transition, the better it is in terms of switching loss. Right? You get less switching loss if the overlapping time is less. So that's why this is a wonderful technology to have. Again, I don't really care much on how they did it. I'm just looking at the data sheet and say, oh, I'm gonna use this next time. It has a better characteristics. Okay. Improving diode turnoff characteristics, another way, right? This is a diode made by Sanrex, and they promised that they have faster reverse recovery, you know, reverse recovery time. And you learn this in E410, right? That when diode turns off, it has reverse recovery time characteristics. It takes some time to turn off, as well as it gives you reverse current that could be dangerous, right? In power circuit, as you learn from E410 as well. So this company claims that, you know, they can shorten this recovery time, right? So that's another way to improve switching loss. The faster the recovery time, the less the overlap. And this last one is the example that I personally, you know, got involved on the application side. Again, I was not involved in the development of the device itself, but I got involved after they finished developing the technology, and then they asked me to basically test their diodes. That was 2006, I believe, when I got invited to work with this company called, at the time, it's still called APD Semiconductor. So I spent 3 months there. And all 3 months that I was there, I came up with ways to basically break this diode. I'd see the limits of this diode, which was a fun job to have, you know, try to break this diode in this case. And so characterizing the diode, basically, that's what I did. So that was fun. That is the technology that they came up with in 2006, and now it's being used commercially. You can purchase this type of diode, super barrier rectifier, you know, SBR diodes, as an alternative to Schottky's, right? So in addition to Schottky's, you can also use now SBR diodes. All right. So those are three examples of improving or minimizing switching loss by improving device, you know, technology, device characteristics. The second one, snubber circuit, we'll talk about next in the following chapter. This is an additional circuit connected around a switch to reduce the overlapping current and voltage waveforms. Right, we'll talk more about the concept first before we go into the snubber itself. We need to understand the real problem with switching loss. Okay? And then from there, you hopefully will understand why snubber can help reduce the switching loss. And then the third one, as I said earlier, this is my one of my favorite topic in power electronics, is soft switching topology. Right? I'm just gonna show you examples of a soft switching version of boost converter. Right? Everybody knows what a boost converter is from E410. Right? You have inductor at the front end, diode on the output, and then switch in the middle. But then you can see there are additional components that we add into the boost converter to make it zero voltage switching. So ZVS stands for zero voltage switching. What it means is that when it turns off, as it turns off, I believe when it is turning off, yes. When it's turning off, the voltage across the switch is zero, right? And so if the voltage across the switch is zero, during the transition, it doesn't matter what current you have through the switch when it's turning off, right? During the transition, V times I is gonna be zero, right? During the transition. So that's why, you know, this is a very good converter to have to minimize switching loss, because we allow voltage across the switch to go to zero first before we're turning off the switch. Very interesting technique. And here's a circuit that one of my grad students did a long time ago for his thesis. He changed the topology slightly to get a zero voltage switch quasi-resonant boost converter. That's his thesis right there. Right. More examples of the advantage or benefits that soft switching offers. You can see the two different bar plots or bar curves here. That get smaller, more. There you go. The top one. We have three different devices, switch at different frequencies. That is the first device right there, IRFP 460 at 50 kilohertz, and then the second device, and then this is the same as the first device. Sorry, that's the same as the first one. But look at the switching frequency, it's different, right? So these plots show you the conduction loss versus switching loss. Okay, and this is done for a PFC circuit. PFC stands for power factor correction circuit, 300 watt PFC circuit. And you can see the mix of the amount of switching loss compared to conduction loss for each one. Right, so you can see you get the blue corresponds to switching loss, whereas the what do you call this color? I don't even know, maroon or something like that.
I'd say maroon, yeah.
Maroon, okay, good. That's a conduction loss, right? You can see that the switching loss is quite significant, even at 300 watts. Watch what happens if soft switching is being used. See that right now? It's this is hard switch. Now it's ZVS soft switch, right? Look at the power, it's 500 watts now compared to 300 watts earlier. Have a look at the switching loss that you get with increased power. You see that? Small compared to conduction loss, right? So that's the kind of benefit you get from soft switching, is that it, even at higher power, you get even lower and lower, you know, switching losses compared to hard switching, method. Okay, so keep in mind, if that's something that you get in the future, right there, this kind of a bar graphs that your switching losses in the converter is too high, you could maybe propose, you know, something like this, right? Propose a solution where you introduce soft switching, and you can see how switching loss is really minimized because of this. Isn't that cool? Don't you want to learn how to do this? I hope you do, right? Because that's really interesting, you know, what we do with this converter, right? And another thing about soft switching, you know, to get you excited, hopefully, about this technology, is that another benefit you get from soft switching is as follows. Let's say you are using isolated topology, such as full bridge. As you can see, this is a full bridge. You got four switches, right? And the load is attached to the secondary side of this transformer. Right there, that's the primary side right here, and that's the secondary side, right? And then you know that every MOSFET has output capacitance as well as internal diode, right? And usually these two parasitics represent issues for us, right? We're trying to minimize their effect. We're trying to fight them, right? Because these are not good for switching transition. Right, capacitor makes it slower, and diode gives you more loss when you're turning off, right? Reverse recovery. So typically we try to fight this. And same thing with the transformer. You learn from E410 that transformer has leakage. Remember leakage inductance of the transformer, which is in series with the transformer itself? That's a problem, right? Because it gives you a leakage spike, right? That could be troublesome to MOSFET. Remember SOA of the MOSFET, the voltage is absolute. And this leakage, right, could give you that spike that forces the trajectory of the voltage to go above SOA voltage limit, right? So we usually try to fight this leakage. You know, we know it exists. Anytime you use transformer, you always end up with leakage, and we always try to fight it. Now, with soft switching, all these parasitics, again, in my opinion, is the one of the coolest thing about soft switching, is that instead of fighting these parasitics, why not befriend them, right? So we don't fight them, we use them. We take advantage of these parasitics. Why fight them? We can, you know, make friends with them, right? So that's the idea behind soft switching, is that all of these parasitics, right, we know they exist. So why not take advantage of those instead of, you know, trying to minimize those parasitics? So by taking advantage of these, I'm not going to explain it now, you can actually achieve, for example, zero voltage switching or soft switching topology, right? For, in this case, for a bridge. And here's an example where one of my grad students did a measurement in the lab. we do have this module, zero voltage, it's a long name, zero voltage switch phase shifted bridge converter. We have that in the lab. And he measures the switching loss using scope. So this is actual screenshot of the oscilloscope. So you can see at different loading condition, at no load, right? You get very tiny switching loss during the switching transition. This represents voltage across the switch, and gate to source represents current through the switch. Right? As source, you can see the overlapping is very tiny. And then as we increase the current to 2.6 amps, you can see the overlapping there, right? You can see the power loss right there, right? Voltage times current, you can see the overlapping increases. What's interesting is that as you increase the current even more, have a look. Look at it, that's now 7.5 amps. Not a small current, is it? We can see that the overlapping now becomes less than before. See that? So the smaller the overlapping means smaller power loss. At even higher current, 10 amps, look, no loss at all. Isn't that cool? I don't know about you, but I think that's one of the coolest thing, right? Again, how did we achieve this? By taking advantage of these parasitics, right? This particular topology, I'm not gonna go over in this class, but 527 is where I go over this. In this class, we go over different topologies, but the concept is the same. Concept's the same, all right? That's it, looks like, yeah, for this chapter. Any question on those different methods of minimizing switching losses?
I had a question on soft switching. Yeah. On its application.
Uh-huh.
Is it typically just used in a higher power application? Because I was looking it up and it said it can't be used in all applications. It's like a pretty specific thing to use.
Yeah, I would say it's not only for high power. I mean, it definitely becomes very useful for high power, especially high voltage. But definitely you can use it for low power, especially when you put high switching frequency into the mix, right?
Okay.
Right, because even at low power, if you use PWM, as you learn from this chapter, from chapter one, that switching loss is gonna be linearly proportional to switching frequency, right? So if you have a 10 watt application or less, if the switching frequency is getting up very high, let's say 5 megahertz or something like that, then definitely the switching loss is gonna be a problem for you, right? Compared to the conduction loss. So if that's the case, then definitely soft switching will be useful to use, okay?
You need to look at power lost for switching. Is that how you like know when to use it? I guess that's my question.
Yeah, so you have to really assess, the loss, like the bar graphs that I have earlier. If you find out that, hey, the switching losses in this converter, even though it's low power, right, percentage-wise, the switching loss is much, much higher than conduction loss, then, that's not good, right? So you need to somehow minimize that switching loss, either by using snubber or by using soft switching. I don't know if that answers your question.
No, it definitely does. It was just a when to use it sort of question, because I was pretty sure you're not just going to spam it on everything you see,
No, of course not.
All circuits.
Exactly, yes. One size doesn't fit all always, right? So you have really to assess power loss in the converter. If switching loss is not a problem, then don't use soft switching. I mean, that's just a waste of money. If PWM can do the job for you, with a minimum amount of switching loss, then just stick with PWM. All right. But before we adjourn today, I just want to introduce you to a snubber circuit. This is the first method I want us to learn about, or technique I want you to learn to minimize switching loss. Keep in mind that a snubber circuit is an additional circuit that you would put around a switch. So it's an extra circuit, okay? Not much, but it does the job. And what a snubber circuit does is that it would reshape switching trajectory. So if let's say that from chapter one, your switching trajectory, the switching trajectory of the device that you use, let's say, is this type of shape right there, right? Then you could reshape that to be, let's say, I don't know, something like this maybe, right? And that's good because you have less area, right? Less area covered under the curve. So again, that's the job of a number circuit, is to reshape the switching trajectory. And its purpose is to minimize switching loss, not necessarily total loss, right? So it's only minimizing switching loss, not necessarily total loss. Keep in mind that loss in the converter consists of many different losses, right? Static loss, switching loss, gate loss, and others. So snubber will only address the switching loss. And you gotta be careful. Again, we'll talk more about this next time. You gotta be careful how you select components in the snubber, because what happens after you add the snubber, right? For sure, the switching loss is gonna be less. So for sure, switching loss is gonna be less. But if you're not careful, then the other losses could be higher, resulted from this additional snubber, if you're not careful. If other losses are higher, that means the total loss of the converter will be higher as well. And that's not good, right? Yeah, you minimize switching losses, but at the expense of higher losses on the other part of the circuit, and that's not good, because then at the end of the day, you really want to minimize total loss of the converter, not just switching loss. So in this chapter, we're gonna learn on how to properly size the snubber circuit so that when you use snubber, not only that you reduce switching loss, but you also reduce other losses such that the total loss will be less than before snubber. Okay, so that's next time. Any questions?